Good. Yeah, the ray trace is fun. I've seen scenes in the past do all kinds of crazy extensions. Again, it's pretty straightforward. Depending on how much render time you spend, or you could try to implement asserted ways of speeding up your ray tracing stuff too. Some of you guys have come to my office hours with ideas for your project, which is great. If you haven't, I encourage you to do so. Judging from the projects that we've seen so far, there's some pretty ambitious ideas out there, which is really great. Yeah, is there a question there, or just
can I actually talk to you after class about language?
You can talk to me after class. Yeah. Are there any questions in the class? Okay, great. So that's that. Your exam's not for another month, so we got some time. Any other procedural questions before we get started for the day? Alright. Great. So today we're going to continue talking about, obviously, another really key component of the rendering pipeline, which is, you know, we just spent the last two lectures, well, four lectures, really, working through all of the details of figuring out when and how a ray is used in an object. And now we have to decide what to do with that information, right? Namely, how to shade it. And so far, basically, the only things we know how to shade are ridiculously boring, right? All we can do is, like, completely ideal mirrors that reflect every single little bit of light. Similarly with, like, what do you call it, refractive objects or Lambertian shading, right? Those are the only options that we have. So today, we're going to introduce a bunch of different material models that can essentially give you all kinds of nice effects for your render shapes. So for instance here, we have our favorite teapot, which has all kinds of different lobes of lighting. You can see here is like kind of a diffuse sky on the upper right, or shining on the left hand side, and so on. And all of these come out of pretty simple calculations for once you've figured out that a ray hits into your object, when you know where the hit happens, what the material is, the normal to your surface, and where the light is. Right? Those are kind of the key pieces of information. Okay. So, obviously, it's not, you know, that difficult to justify why you need to talk about lighting and material in a computer graphics class. And really, this is what the main input that's needed for realistic rendering. Right? So in addition to having geometry and lighting, you also have to know what all the objects in your scene are made out of. Right? And so that includes, like, whether your object has highlights or not, whether they're glossy, and you know, if there's some spatial variation. For instance, a lot of objects are multi-material, like this table in front of me has a shiny part and a not shiny part, and you need to be able to distinguish between those in a coherent fashion, right? And part of this is physics, and part of it is art. As we've seen repeatedly in this class, there's sort of two ways to go about modeling this stuff, right? One is to actually go back to your physics and try and measure things like reflectance and so on. The other is to say, well, maybe I noticed that surfaces that I light head-on tend to be brighter than things that I light sideways, and I try to encode that as a rule, and then go back and double-check how well that captures the physical world. Yeah? And the computer graphics world, I mean, unsurprisingly, really has been the leaders in understanding materials for a very long time, at least understanding material reflectance rather. And has developed some of the most complicated models, some of which go back into the material science physics world, right? So there's definitely some back and forth there. Yeah? Right. So one of the things that we're not going to cover a lot of in today's lecture, because we only get one lecture to talk about shading, is radiometry, right? So radiometry is this set of techniques for measuring electromagnetic radiation, and you can imagine that radiometry is incredibly important in the computer graphics world, right? Understanding precisely how a material reacts to every wavelength of light, you can imagine it's really, really, really accurate, nice materials from the stuff that you render. But in this class, we're mostly aimed at capturing like 90% of the materials around you, which are either shiny or diffuse objects, where sort of the complicated relationships between the objects and the scene come less from really, really crazy materials with very specific specular lobes or whatever, and more from, you know, the fact that light is bouncing around the scene. Right? These are two different reasons why you might see some really nice effects. So in particular, this is going to come up, and we're going to be completely, completely cavalier about things like units in today's lecture. So we're going to talk a lot about, like, well, I'm going to take this number and multiply it by something small because I'd like there to be less light coming you know, out of the surface when the, when it's grazing this way, you know, these kind of phenomenological things, but we're not going to talk about things like surface integrals over the surface of the sphere, which, as you can imagine, is quite important for capturing, rendering at the most physical possible level. The other simplification that we're going to make today is that when we talk about color, we're going to talk about it in terms of red, green, and blue. Yeah. And I think you guys all know this, you know, if you download an image in JPEG or PNG format or whatever, essentially your image is composed of three channels, red, green, and blue. There's a reason for that, which is your eye has three different receptors for red, green, and blue wavelengths of light. Toward the end of this class, we'll talk about perceptual issues and precisely what's going on inside of your eye. But for now, we're going to take that as kind of basic fact. And the way we're going to set up our math today is that essentially, to get color in your object, you're going to do three calculations. One, which is a black and white calculation that turns into your red channel, right? One that's going to turn into your green channel, one that's going to turn into your blue. So we're not going to do anything wild and crazy involving like splitting light based on its spectrum and doing some Fourier decomposition. And that's not just because 6837 is lazy. That really is realistically what goes on in most graphics pipelines. Unless, again, you have some like really bizarre iridescent material that really strongly needs an understanding of exactly the spectral decomposition of your light bulb. Which does come up, right? In particular, like lighting an outdoor scene is quite different from lighting a room lit with fluorescent lights, because if you guys look at the spectrum of fluorescent light, it has a very different signature than what comes out of the sun. Yeah. And so there are some cases where this is necessary, but for now, we're going to disregard. Cool? Okay. But even so, lighting is in this incredibly, or rather materials, is this incredibly complex, fascinating discipline. And really, I encourage you when you get out of the class to just walk around MIT and look at all the really wild and crazy materials that are around you. Like, even really ordinary objects have really interesting behavior, right? Like, one of the really cool ones is people's hair, right? This is not an issue for me, but if you look at a lot of people, you know, especially long hair, it turns out that like different colors of hair reflect light in very different ways. It's not just a matter of color. For example, some colors of hair, I think blonde hair has actually two kind of specular lobes. So typically you actually can see two highlights, even though maybe there's only one light source, which has to do with kind of the internal reflection that goes on in the interior of your hair strand. There's all kinds of strange phenomena. And as you can imagine, people in graphics are really excited about capturing every single one. This is like an easy formula for like a cool research project or new, you know, feature for your engineering. Yeah? Okay. Today, you know, continuing in our laundry list of all the simplifying sessions we're going to make, we're mostly going to talk about light sources. So in particular, hopefully those of you guys who have taken some advanced math can see what I'm doing, is I'm essentially getting rid of any reason that I have to take it anymore. Yeah? And in this class, I think that's necessary. However, when you don't have a point light source, it's not like something really crazy happens. In fact, in our previous ray tracing lectures, we've already talked about one totally reasonable strategy for what to do when your light doesn't consist of just a single little point, right? Which is namely, you just sort of average the response of your surface over a lot of different light sources that are all kind of jiggled around on the surface of your area light. Yeah? And that's a perfectly reasonable and, in fact, to some physical degree, the correct thing to do. Notice, by the way, that when we talk about rasterization, which would be like an algorithm that paints stuff as opposed to our ray tracing algorithm where it kind of sends rays out and queries their color, like painting something and averaging over a bunch of light sources would become a very tricky math, right? That sort of is specific to the ray tracing algorithm that we can do. Okay. Great, so anyway, one way to understand that is that really linearity is your friend here, right? That essentially if I have two light sources, yeah, then roughly the amount of light that comes out of your surface is the sum of the amount of light that comes from light A plus the amount of light that comes from light B, right? And you have to have a pretty crazy material for that, not to be the case, right? And so as long as you assume that, then assuming that your area light source is really just kind of a superposition of lots of little guys that you average over is completely reasonable. Yeah. Does that make sense so far? Great. Okay. So now we're going to set out on our journey for the day, which is to say, okay, I just figured out that a ray hits into my surface. I know where the light is. What color should I put there? Yeah, that's the question we're going to answer. And the first thing to answer is that light pretty obviously gets darker the farther you are away from it. And I think we all know this intuitively, but maybe it's important to kind of kind of point out why, right? A light source does not have an infinite amount of energy, I hope. Obviously, if you think about the amount of light that's received from a surface, as the surface moves farther and farther away from the point light, what happens? Well, I mean, think about it. If your point light is just emanating energy in all directions kind of in an equal way, right? That's getting spread out over the surface of the unit sphere, yeah? But the farther you are away from the light source, the bigger that sphere is, because it's no longer a unit, yeah? So roughly, the amount of light that you receive from a point light source looks like 1 over r squared, where r is the distance to light, yeah? And why is that? Well, r squared looks like surface area, yeah? And essentially, the energy of the light at a radius r is spread over a surface of area r squared, you know, plus or minus some constants. What is the constant in this case? 4/3 pi? Doesn't matter. That's spreading out all this energy, yeah? And so that's where you get this scale. So, this is your first ridiculously easy way to make your ray tracer a little better, right? You started with Lambertian shading. Remember that I know where the light is, I know the normal to my surface, and how much light gets reflected. Do you remember this? It's proportional to what? Cosine, yeah, right? So that way when they're incident, it's loud, I'm loud, the light's bright, and as they go to 90 degrees, then the intensity drops off, yeah? One way to make a slightly more realistic scenario is to take that number that you scale by cosine, and at least multiply it by 1 over r squared, because you know the farther you are from holding your light, the less light you receive, yeah? Okay. And obviously, if you're in a ray tracer, you already kind of have r, right? Because you have the length of your ray, and so sort of. Incidentally, you have to be a little bit careful in a ray tracer. Let's say that I have a light and there's a mirror, right? And I'm trying to calculate the light bounces off of the mirror into the surface or something like that. Then you better be careful about that 1 over r squared, right? Because it actually is the sum of two distances. Okay. This is a very harsh light source in general, so in graphics we tend to deal with this in a slightly different way, which is to put a quadratic polynomial in the 1 over r squared to just say, like, for instance, when r goes to 0, like, you won't want to be like completely blinded by the light, which is roughly what this rule would do, right? Which makes sense, because there's no such thing as an ideal point light source, right? But of course, in reality, you probably would want something that dims it out just a little bit at close distances. Okay. So now, what this allows us to do is to talk about the incoming irradiance to a surface, right? And that's the amount of light energy that you get at a surface at a point. And it depends on two things, right? Well, it depends on many things, really, but two principally, right? One is the distance between the light and the surface, and the other is the angle between this incoming vector from the light and the normals of the surface, right? This Lambertian idea. In particular, like, let's say that I replace my point light source with a laser, so now all my lights are going parallel, the light rays. Then what would happen if I had my laser parallel to the surface? Would the surface get lit? No, right? Like, the laser would just go right past the surface, right? So the only light that you see is the stuff that's coming in normal. So in particular, this is exactly Lambertian shading, right? This idea that cosine of the angle between the light ray and the surface normal is really what determines the amount of light that gets bounced off the surface. The rest just kind of grazes parallel. Does that make sense? And so that is your incoming irradiance. It's the amount of light energy that gets to the surface just along this vector multiplied by that cosine so that if it grazes past you, it counts. Cool? There. And of course, in practice, how do you compute the irradiance? Well, we all know one of many ways to compute cosine is using the dot product. And conveniently for us, we know the direction of our ray, we know the direction of the normal, so that's how we do it. Right? The one gotcha being that you better hope that your vectors are uniform. Yeah? Okay. All right, so what we're going to do today is we're going to slowly add on, well, like, we're going to tack on more and more terms in our shading equation and get nicer and nicer looking images. Right? So now, we can combine these two things, and now we have a nice formula for light that comes off of a really, really boring, like, terracotta surface, which is that you have the intensity of the light, this is just the amount of energy that's kind of sitting right at this point, and you scale up by 1 over r squared, because it traveled over here, And then you scale it by cosine of this angle to deal with the fact that some of the light just grazes on the surface and doesn't bounce. Right? And this gives you this shading law here. So I is what you would call the irradiance or intensity at this point x. Right? So I in, I guess, is the irradiance here. I less is the intensity of the light, and this is the relationship between them. And this is just constructed from what we just talked about. Does this make sense? So far it's pretty straightforward. Right? So you can understand 1 over r squared as just kind of like the surface area of a sphere, accounting for that. And you can think of the cosine law as essentially accounting for the fact that you decompose a vector as a parallel part and an orthogonal. Okay. Cool. So one slight difference in lighting that I think is equally easy to model is rather than having a point light where everything kind of comes out of a dot, you might pretend like your light is infinitely far away and infinitely bright. This is roughly the situation we have outdoors, at least when the sun is rainy, as it is today, which is that the sun is really, really far away. So by the time the rays of light from the sun get to us, it's not like if I like step over here onto the other side of the classroom, all of a sudden like the sun's light rays have like shifted 45 degrees, right? Because the sun is really, really far. So we typically like that. You know, we don't account for like some point and then this like swing angle here, but rather we just assume that the light has some constant angle coming in from the outside. So that would be called a directional light. It's very simple. Essentially, in that case, it doesn't really make sense to account for 1 over r squared, right, if you think about it, because there's no r to be had anymore. So you just kind of ignore that. Yes?
So, I mean, when you said I think that it doesn't matter how far away you are from the object you're looking at in terms of its brightness, is that correct? So like the object closer to me has the same brightness by the sun, but there's a farther object from me. It's still lit by the same sun, but it's farther from me. Their brightness is, I guess, it's as far as sun
increases. Right, so you're saying, like, why doesn't this chair get really bright if I get on top of it?
Yeah.
Right, but I think this has to do with the difference between stuff that's integrated over a sphere as opposed to the stuff that you see at a point. Right, that the total amount of energy that comes out of this chair doesn't change depending on how far back. So the only thing that I can measure is how much I reflect off from that rather than how much is received by the light. That's a kind of a lame explanation. I'm trying to think of a better way to really. Yeah. Okay, great questions. You guys will quickly learn in this lecture that I am not a physicist. Okay. Right, another type of light which is equally easy to model. And by the way, if you download Maya, like, you know, just the usual kind of animation software, you look at the lighting menu at the top. Essentially, we're just going across that menu right now. The third light that you might talk about, in addition to point light and directional light, is a spotlight. Exactly what it sounds like. So spotlight does have a location, but in addition, we give a spotlight a direction, right? And so the idea, roughly, when you think about a point light, you think of it emanating intensity equally in all directions. The spotlight comes with an additional thing, which is a function of the angle from the direction of your spotlight saying how much energy comes out. Yeah. So let's say that I'm over here and I want to render this point. I draw a light ray. But now my spotlight has its own direction, and I want to know how much light is received by this point. Yeah. And like one thing I could do, for example, would be to use cosine. Right? And that would give me some drop off from the center. People model this in different ways, which makes sense, but I mean, if you look, like if you go on a stage and you look at an actual spotlight, there's all kinds of cool stuff that happens in the inside to give you the drop-off that you want on the outside of the center of it. And so roughly you can model this as some function of the angle from the center. Does that make sense? So these are all just kind of heuristic ways to model different types of light. So the way to think about a spotlight is just that it's a point light, but the emission is not uniform. It doesn't just spray light everywhere, but rather the amount of light that you receive is a function of the angle from the direction of the sun. Yeah. And so typically, the way that people model this is that like in some small cone around the direction of the spotlight, it's just constant intensity, and then there's this little angle here, which is the falloff, and then zero there. Yeah, so you might, if you're an artist and you're looking to engineer lighting for a scene, you might literally draw a function where this is theta, right? And you're looking, you're saying like, here's the direction of my spotlight, here's the surface, right? And I can measure theta as this angle, right? And you could engineer a function which says how much intensity do I see, right? right? So for a point light, the function would be this, right? If you use a straight line, doesn't matter what height you have. Right? For something like this, you might say, okay, in my spotlight angle, I have full intensity, and then in my drop-off, I smoothly go to zero, and outside of there, I don't have any range. So this is an easy thing to observe. That makes sense. By the way, let's say I wanted to engineer a curve like this, and I asked an artist to do that. How do you think that they, like, what is the user interface using when you do this? Spezier curves, yeah, exactly. So, it all comes back. Okay. Here's another picture of sort of the typical geometry of a spotlight, right? That, like, even though you might not see circles reflected off the ground, it's because the plane of the ground is not parallel to the direction. So those are our three main types of lighting. Of course, there's all kinds of cool lighting that people can think of in practice. And essentially for every, you know, like if you go to a photo shoot and you see all the cool lighting that like actual people use in real life, like for every one of those, somebody has tried to come up with a digital version. And they're really quite easy to model, right? I mean, typically you write down some falloff function and you know some idea of what direction your light is going, and that's really easy. I recently experienced this because I had MIT force me to have a faculty photo shoot, which could have been the most awkward 45 minutes of my life. Okay. right. So, they asked you, they said, like, okay, write equations. Like, do math on the board. And, like, you know, it's like when somebody, like, goes up and says, okay, tell a joke, and you just can't. Right? Like, so I started writing, and now my official faculty photo has me trying to prove integration by parts and getting confused. it's unfortunate. Yeah. Actually, I kind of like it. Okay. So more. Our next step is to make more interesting materials. Right. So far we've talked about how the light gets to the surface, and then the amount of light that gets to the surface that actually kind of is involved in your lighting effort. Right? First one is the 1 over r squared, and the next one is the cosine. Yeah? Our next ingredient is going to be how much light actually gets reflected off out of that incoming amount of stuff. Yeah? And that is typically modeled using a function called a BRDF, a bidirectional reflectance distribution function, which is a very poorly named object that we're stuck with thanks to some researcher in the 1980s that gave it that name. And so, probably earlier than that, actually, I don't know who invented the term BRDF. But it's like one of these initials that all graphics people know. You said BRDF, they don't know. Yeah, Rafa.
The computer vision professor said that there was like a conference where all of them came together and decided on that.
They decided like on the longest possible phrase. and none of us were probably born at that point. That's lovely. We can go talk to whoever your vision professor is. Okay. So the BRDF, the essential idea of a BRDF is the ratio of the amount of light coming in from one direction to the amount that comes out in another direction. Right? So in other words, like my eyeball is over here, my light is over there, and so what I'm trying to figure out is how much of this light makes it to my eyeball. And that's the BRDF function. So it's a function of two directions, the incoming direction and the outgoing one. Yeah? So in general, kind of how, you know, if I think of this as a function like f of x, how many inputs would go to f if you kind of your degree of freedom count? I see this like rule.
Four.
Louder.
Four.
A little louder.
Four.
There you go. Four.
Yeah.
So right. So essentially, how many numbers do you need to parameterize a point on the sphere? Two. Right. Sphere is like a two-dimensional surface. So if you kind of think of it like being a sphere sitting around this point here, then you need two numbers to parameterize the incoming direction, another two to parameterize the outgoing direction. So in general, we think of our BRDF as a function of four angles. These angles are shown here. These are what, spherical angles, I guess what you call these. So roughly, if you think about it, it makes sense to write your BRDF in the coordinate system of the surface normal. Right, because sort of that's the thing that's usually what determines shading. Right? So we have these four angles, theta and phi in, and theta and phi out. It's pretty self-explanatory what these things mean. So in general, I don't know if you remember from calculus class how spherical angles work, but there's like one angle which is rotation about the normal, and then another angle which is rotation above the tangent. Okay? So this angle is theta, So when theta equals zero, it's coincident with the normal, and as you deviate from the normal, theta increases. Notice that for once our lecture was self-consistent, right? Cosine of theta is actually the Lambertian model. Yeah. And then phi would be this thing. Yeah. So as a sanity check, let's say that my surface is, well, echoes down. I'm very tired, so I could distract you. If your material is isotropic, meaning that like, you know, it doesn't look like I brushed it in a particular direction in the tangent plane, can I say something about my function f? If you think about it, then f really shouldn't depend much on the phi angles, right? Because phi is measuring just your angle of the tangent. Okay. So again, really the key thing to remember here is that the BRDF is aligned with the surface, right? So like at another point on your money, your surface normal is like probably this way. So you would probably think of rotating this function with the surface normal rather than like kind of leaving it here. I can't think of a surface for which that would happen. Okay. Right. So you have sort of two different options for how to write a BRDF. You could write it in terms of spherical angles. If you're like me and you can never remember which spherical angle is which, probably an easier thing to do is to just think of it as a function of two vectors, right? One vector pointing to the light and one to the phi. Again, these kinds of details are ones that don't matter. Like, I can't say that enough. Like, I think MIT kids get hooked up, they're like kind of confused about this kind of stuff. Like, the way that we notate a BRDF has like no importance whatsoever, because as long as it looks right in your code, that's fine, right? This is an indicator for like when you're emailing me asking like, will this be on the exam? The answer is always no if it involves like, which four numbers do we use in this class to memorize BRDF? Doesn't matter. Okay. Anyway. Right, so typically, the way that we think about the BRDF function is that it relates the incident irradiance from every direction to the outgoing light using this function here. So the idea is that your outgoing irradiance, so this is like what you would see at your viewer, you know, at your viewing angle, it depends on a few things. Depends on just the amount of light that makes it to the surface, times the BRDF, which tells you the fraction of the light that makes it to the surface that makes it to the viewer. Yeah? So in particular, to do a sanity check here, you know, if we know something about point lights, then our function in that case looks something like this, right? That would be intensity of the light, and then in this case, it's divided by r squared. That's how much just makes it to that point, right? Minus this term. And then the cosine accounts for the fact that not all of the light actually bounces off the surface, so I'm just going to move this parallel. And then the fraction of that stuff that's left is the BRDF. Yeah. So in particular, a Lambertian surface, what is the BRDF? Like, what will be that function f? Remember, Lambertian is cosine shading? If nothing else, you can kind of reverse engineer it from this equation here. What was that? Not quite. So what is the function f if my surface is Lambertian? So again, remember Lambertian means that the total amount of light that I see looks like cosine over r squared. Well, those are already there, so what's that? I can see you know the answer.
Just 1.
It's just 1. Yeah. Right, because remember that this is the Lambertian shading law, right? So this is the amount that got left over from this number. It's just 1. So one way to understand BRDF is the amount of Lambertian shading that gets left over after it starts bouncing off the surface. Yeah? Okay. Right. And there are all kinds of different ways to visualize and understand this function. Typically, one way that people do this is they'll make plots that look like this. How many of you guys have seen this, by the way? If you kind of dig through like OpenGL documentation or something, you'll see a function. So roughly the idea here is that I fix the direction of some incoming light source. I need to draw it on this plot, or else you know I won't be able to understand it. And then now, the amount of light that gets bounced off is just a function of the outgoing direction. And so you can think of this like a height over the sphere. Yeah? And so that's what's getting plotted here. Right, so this is saying if the light comes in here, then most of it gets bounced off that. Yeah, so this is like a kind of sort of reflective. Cool. So again, a Lambertian surface would be one for which this is just constant. Cool. All right. By the way, because this kind of looks like a spherical function, you might remember from calculus class or engineering class that there are lots of nice approximations of functions on spheres, right? So remember there's Fourier. Does everybody remember what the Fourier basis is on a sphere? It's called the spherical harmonics. Yeah. And a very typical thing to use in rendering is to write your BRD in the spherical harmonic basis. You can get in trouble if you do that, however, because functions like cosine and sine have negative numbers in them, and having a negative BRDF is a pretty frightening thing. Now we reach Justin's least favorite word in the computer graphics literature, because I can never say it, which is anisotropy. So the idea here is that lots of materials are anisotropic. And the idea being that, you know, when they take light in, it really depends on the direction of the light source and the viewer when you see the reflected light, right? So a good example of this would be like I take a piece of metal, like so almost any appliance in your kitchen looks like this, where if I take a piece of metal and then I take like a scrubber on it, and I scrub it in like parallel lines, right? Then in one direction my surface kind of looks like a mirror, and in the other direction it looks very rough, right? So at the end of the day I get these highlights that kind of look like lines. Yeah? Go back, be like, go in your kitchen and go. I know that a lot of college kids have stainless steel appliances, and so go take a look, and what you'll see is that you have anisotropic behavior, meaning that you really do need to understand both the incoming and outgoing direction to write down the BRDF. And we'll talk about a few models for this. So typical materials that have anisotropic shading include brushed metal. For some reason, that's the one graphics people always go to. I think it's because brushed metal like is particularly easy to model. Hair, which is particularly difficult to model well, fur, cloth, velvet is an interesting one that's typically kind of a stress test in a lot of rendering pipelines. All of these things, essentially one way to understand them is that they have oriented microgeometry, which is like a really weird thing to say, but it makes complete sense if you think about it. Right? So like think about a brushed metal surface. Like how did I get it? Well, I took a brush to a piece of metal, yeah? And so what ended up happening is on the macro scale, my surface still looks smooth, right? Like when I stroke my KitchenAid, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't feel that rough to me. if you zoom in really, 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 really close, the surface has these little micro bumps on it, but they're all kind of in parallel lines because of the way that I scrub this thing down. Right? So that's this idea that you have oriented microgeometry. And so a lot of times when people are deriving BRDF as function, what they'll do is kind of start with some principle of like physically, like we kind of think that microgeometry looks like this, and then they'll direct some macro scale thing from it. And we'll see an example. Other things people do is actually just measure the BRDF. Yeah? And this brings us to our next giant vocabulary word that I can't say, which is gonioreflectometer. So the idea of a gonioreflectometer is exactly what it sounds like. It's essentially like you know, if you took an old record player and you put a little sample of your material on top of it, right? Or actually, I guess they're not old record players anymore, right? Those are making a comeback now. Yeah. But anyway, you put your material on top of a turntable, and then well, remember, what is the BRDF? It's every possible combination, incoming light ray, you know, like incoming light and outgoing light, right? So essentially, a gonioreflectometer. Is a 4 degree of freedom system that's trying to capture exactly that. Right? So you put your thing on a turntable, you turn it to an angle, then you can lift your reflectance detector to different angles just along a circle. Right? So notice that this turntable plus this 1 degree of freedom is enough to kind of parameterize all the possible ways to receive light. And then you have this additional object sitting on top, which is like a big arc that is on its own little turntable. Or maybe you don't, actually I guess you don't even need that because this turntable moves. Yeah? And this chooses a third angle. And then you can try every possible combination of incoming light and receivers. Yeah? And so if you want to capture material in an incredibly painful and exhausting fashion, you can do that using a gonioreflectometer by essentially just sitting there like, you know, chunking your turntable a little bit, write down the number, turn it a little bit, write down the number. Obviously, these days, this is automated, and it's very easy to roboticize this kind of thing. And all kinds of computer graphics literature, starting with this kind of obvious setup, has made more interesting extensions. Right? So for instance, one of the really cool ones that I like from, I think it's from Kavita Bala at Cornell, where they essentially just take a material and throw it in a flatbed scanner and then show that like if you control your flatbed scanner the right way, you can capture a pretty serious part of your BRDF. Other people have put their objects literally into a CT scan, like the same thing that looks at the inside of your leg or whatever when you break it, to really understand the microstructure and capture material. So this is like a very serious study that people do because they really want to capture that last little bit of detail and like silk or whatever it is. Okay, here's what this looks like in practice. So here's actually a different way to obtain a BRDF that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. So, I mean, the gonio reflectometer is sort of the obvious one, and I think like all the way through the 1800s, this is what people did, and then somebody realized like, well, that's dumb. You could do something much easier, which is, let's say that I have a material, and I coat an entire sphere with that material, and I light it from far away, so the light rays are more or less parallel. Yeah. So what happens if I take a photo of that sphere? I actually get, if you think about it, the amount of light that reflects off of that sphere as a function of a lot of different normal directions, right? Of all the different normals that you can see in this frame, right? So if you want to simplify your gonio reflectometer quite a bit, I have no idea if I'm saying the word correctly. One way to do that would be to essentially take a sphere and just rotate a light around it and have a fixed camera position. And this will work at least for isotropic materials. For anisotropic stuff, we really have to vary every possible angle. It's a little tricky to extend this thing. Right? And that makes sense, right? Because if you have an anisotropic material, then that means that like you brushed this sphere somehow. So like, it would matter how you stuck it on this pole. And then things get a little tricky. Okay. Great, so one way or the other, there are a lot of different ways to obtain BRDFs. And there's sort of two things you could do with it once you get to that. One, which is kind of a popular idea right now, is you collect that data and then you put it in your favorite machine learning pipeline and out comes your learned BRDF from a material. You guys laugh, but that's actually what people do, right? Because the materials are really complicated. If you're like maybe 10, 20 years ago, or if you don't want to use a stupid amount of CPU time, you can just say, okay, I'm going to take some parametric BRDF, like a BRDF with some degrees of freedom that I can tune to try and match a material. And now that I have a bunch of examples of that material, I can try to tune the parameters to measure that. Right? Like for instance, maybe I know that my surface is Lambertian, but I don't know what color it is, so I take a photo of it, and I can obviously adjust the color of the Lambertian object to agree. Yeah, that's a really obvious version. Okay. So anyway, the takeaway here is that you really can measure a BRDF using one of these things, at least in an inaccurate fashion. Measuring them accurately is quite tricky, right? Because you have to control them. You can find a room where you can turn off all the lights, and you can control the direction of your one source, and you have a really good camera, and there's no inter-reflection, and all that kind of stuff. And like your grad students can't wear glasses because those will reflect the light. It's messy stuff. Yep. Right. But a much easier thing, and really how people derive BRDF for quite a long time, was sort of just phenomenologically. Right, so you would have some function that you cook up at home where you say, well, I noticed that shiny things tend to have lobes there, and maybe anisotropic things tend to have lobes that kind of look like ovals or whatever, and you construct a function and then just control it with your parameters as opposed to trying to measure. Yep. And there's so many different models for this, right? There's the diffuse one, which is another word for Lambertian shading. There's Blinfong, Cooke-Torrens, LaFortune, Ward, Oren Nair, I don't know what the fortune is, but the rest of these things. And they're all just different functions of like where the light is, where the viewer is, where the noble is. So let's think of a few. So the simplest one is diffuse reflectance, which is just saying that a surface reflects light equally in all directions. In other words, there's no kind of mirror, glossy, or shiny. So in that case, sort of one way to think about a diffuse surface is that it's just super rough. That's why I keep saying terracotta, like when you go to Home Depot and you buy those pots that are like kind of orangish, right? Those are terracotta pots. Or if you go to like underground in China somewhere, there are all these warriors that are terracotta. And one way or the other, they're made of this kind of concrete material, which just is so bumpy that like there's no, you don't have to worry about light coming in and then bouncing off and everything. It just comes in and spreads out everywhere. because at a micro level, your surfaces contain so many facets that are bouncing your life in all these different directions. Yep. If you're bored, you should take like a clay pot and put it under a microscope. You'll see, I think it's pumping. Trust me. Okay, so, and this is this Lambertian cosine law, which is just saying that the only thing that matters is the amount of light that touches the surface, right? Because the second it touches the surface, it just gets bounced out with complete energy. All right. There are a couple of vocabulary words even in this setting that are worth knowing. One of them is sort of the ratio of the amount of light that comes in versus the amount that comes out, right? Not all sort of, like, even if you have a diffuse surface, it doesn't mean that it conserves energy, right? Like, that would be like your terracotta pot is like really overwhelming if you put it in the sun, right? So instead, the ratio is some coefficient of the light that comes in to the light that bounces out, and that's called albedo. Albedo is very important. Albedo is very important because it roughly, for example, if you're talking about the surface of the Earth, right, that's changing quite a bit thanks to global warming, if you believe in that, because there's less reflectance, and this actually has a big effect on the energy that gets trapped inside of the Earth. But so there's sort of two places where you see the word albedo show up, right? One of them is in computer graphics. The other is in like people that talk about, you know, how much of the sun's energy gets reflected off of the surface back into space as opposed to gets absorbed by the ground and heats the Earth. Yeah. Or doesn't heat the Earth. You know, like that. Right. So so in general, that coefficient we call the diffuse color, K sub D, and I think you've already coded this up, right? Just by taking that part. Yeah. Oh, I was just stretching. Okay, cool. Right. So this is a very simple BRDF, and it's just parameterized by one number, which is the amount of stuff. Cool. All right. If we want to make our equations look more complicated, we can do that. Here's one fashion which we might do that. So here is essentially all of the different parameters that you have for your light source, right? The normal, the direction to your light, the radius, and so on. One detail that we haven't talked about so far is that dot products can be negative, right? And obviously, you wouldn't want to have a negative amount of light. So what you really should do in your code is clamp your dot product at zero. This makes sense because essentially otherwise you're talking about kind of lighting the surface from underneath the surface, and that doesn't make any sense at all. No. So really that should be caught by occlusion, but in case it's not, you have a negative number, you should get rid of it. Okay. Cool. By the way, for the rest of the lecture today and for the rest of this class, I'm not going to bother clamping all your dot products at zero, but anytime you take dot product and you're doing lighting, that's like half is key, then you should clamp it.
So, and all of this, like, reflectance we're talking about, we're only talking about the intensity of the materials, the luminance itself, right? Not, like, reflectance as in a mirror.
That's a great question. What happens with mirrors? So, let's talk about that. Right. So, yeah, it's good. I plant these things in the audience. Right. So mirrors and diffuse surfaces are at opposite extremes, obviously. So a diffuse surface takes in energy at a point, and then just spews it out, right? Like with no, it doesn't care what happens. Whereas a reflective surface has a BRDF where essentially if light comes in at this angle, it has to go out at only one angle, right? In fact, we worked through the math on that. So what does your BRDF function look like for a fixed light direction? If you think about it, it's what we call a Dirac delta function, right? Meaning that essentially for every fixed light position, there's only one reflected direction that matters. And that makes sense, right? So if you have a point light source, yeah, and I ask you to play this game, which is look in a mirror and find the point light source, you're not going to be able to do it, right? Because it's going to look like nothing until you align your eye right with that point light source, and all of a sudden you're going to get like zapped, right? And that's roughly what this thing is. Because remember that a point light source is this very ideal kind of like laser-like object. It's not. So if you guys remember, we already talked about how to do all that stuff, and I referred to a few lectures from before. One small extension beyond what we already talked about. So the mirrors that we covered in ray tracing were like completely ideal energy-preserving mirrors. Typically, that's not really a thing, right? So really, you would take your Dirac delta and scale it by some coefficient. Okay, so yeah, so this is not super useful rule for point lights, right? Because multiplying things by delta functions is kind of a hard thing to carry out on a computer. But when you start talking about reflecting other surfaces, then, because essentially, then you're not really seeing the mirror, you're seeing the surface that you reflected, right? But anyway, this is the kind of thing where, like, again, it's hard to think about in this language because BRDS aren't really built for ideal mirrors, but your code, it's very easy, right? You just reflect array and scale it by the scales. Okay. So now we have to talk about what's in between, right? These are non-ideal reflectors. So these are like glossy things or maybe mirror-like surfaces that also have some lows and highlights and diffuse and all this stuff put together. Yeah. And so these aren't ideal diffuse surfaces either, they're somewhere in between. And there's so many different models for how to do this. Yeah. And so roughly, the typical kind of reasoning here is, you know, your BRDF for an ideal mirror looks like what? If you have an incoming ray, then your outgoing ray is just you know, a single, like basically a little point here. And what we're going to do is just blur that thing. We'll call that glossy material. Cool? All right. So right. So the idea here is that you know, if again we think about our sort of phenomenological approach to physics here, if you think of the ideal surface of a mirror as being really smooth, then the way to think about this is it's more like my bathroom mirror. Like, you know, there's enough crap on the top of it that things get spread out a little bit when they bounce, right? And so roughly, the more kind of stuff that you have that gets in the way of just that ideal smooth surface of your mirror, the more spreading out of those rays when they bounce off of these little micro facets. Yeah. Okay. So one very, very simple model of this that it's just kind of constructed. It's like not even really a BRDF. It's something we call Phong shading. This is a very popular shading model in 1980s video games. And it's sometimes used as kind of a base layer for more complicated shading things. So a very typical approach to making a pretty complicated shader would be like, take five of these things and have them all together. So your phone might make like a nice kind of pretty smooth base for your shading. And the idea is that if you look at the so what do you think is going to happen if you do shading and you have a surface that's reflected, right? Well, so far, the direction to the viewer, if you had a completely diffuse surface, the direction to the viewer doesn't matter, right? Because the diffuse surface just reflects the same side everywhere, right? And conversely, if you have a purely reflective surface, then the direction of the viewer matters 100% because you reflect the viewer direction off this way and just collect whatever light is over there, yeah? So in the Phong model, you kind of take the halfway approach, quite literally, which because what they do is they start averaging vectors together in kind of a funny fashion. But anyway, in the Phong model, the simplest way to view it is that I now have two angles, one of which is alpha, which is the angle between the viewer and the reflected ray. Right. So if this were a purely reflective surface, then you would only see the light if you were at exactly this point. Do you see that? So if I take cosine of alpha, right, this is a number that's 100% when you align, it kind of drops off, right? You can see how Phong thought through this. This is not physics. This was just like, kind of like, what are things that I want to be true about my shader, right? So what did he say? Well, he said, well, I want the most light to happen right when I'm aligned with that reflective direction, right? So that would be like cosine, and I want it to drop off as that angle increases. So that sounds like cosine. And let's say that cosine doesn't drop off fast enough, right? I want a function that drops off really quick. Yeah? Well, what's enough? If I take a number that's between 0 and 1, I take it to a high power, what happens to it? It goes to 0, right? So what Phong did is he said, okay, great. So I'm going to put this number Q here, which is going to control the drop-off from the reflected direction. Yeah? So if Q is really, really big, right, then what's going to happen as alpha increases is very quickly reflectance is going to just go to 0. Right? So in other words, it's going to look very much like just a purely reflective surface. Yeah. And when Q is small, then it's starting to look more Lembertian. Yeah. Right. And then the rest of these terms are exactly the same, right? So you just have the 1 over R squared. So the only difference here is that now, rather than just taking into account, you know, the normal and the light direction, instead you're going to take into account the light direction and the viewer in a way that's like kind of sort of reflective of the light. Okay, that's what you're going to do. Yeah. if you're wondering why this is fishy, it's because it is, right? Like, this is just built to look kind of right. And so one way to understand that is, just like I talked about, remember that we have this Q parameter, which is controlling the drop-off from, like, purely reflective, right? So if Q is really, really small, right, what's almost any number to the zero with power? Instead of axioms you buy into. So in that case, right, this really has no effect if your surface is just spreading light everywhere. And as Q drops down, this sort of sharpens just about the reflective direction. So this is called a funnel. So the fancy word for this is called the specular lobe. And this is this idea that this is sort of this little angle where you see the light that's being reflected off of a funnel surface. Right? This is where the drop off. And so the shape of the specular lobe, like if you want to impress people at dinner parties, is governed by this function r dot v to the alpha, or to the q rather. And so r dot v is that cosine, where r is the reflected ray direction, and the q controls the drop off, which in this picture controls sort of the shape of this ellipse. Cool. All right. So in reality, if you like go back and you track down Fong's original academic paper, it wasn't just this one term, but really what he did is he said, okay, well, a surface is some combination of three things. One is just a completely ideal reflection. Another is this kind of specular, lobey reflection thing. And the third is just diffuse. So what do we do if we don't know anything better to? We just add them all together. Yeah, and that's what he means. So when we talk about the Fong shading model, typically one way to think about it is that I shaded my surface three times. One is that I give it a constant color, which is just completely non-physical. Another is that I use Lambert's cosine law. And then a third is that I use this alpha thing. And then Fong just adds them all together, and then that's like a surface that has a little bit of each, right? You grab a little from column A, a little from column B, a little from column C. Yeah? And this is the Fong one. And it's actually, like, over time it's been proven to be physical-ish. Right, like the idea being that, like, if I have these little microfacets, on average, maybe their normal really is aligned, to the outward direction, and that makes some kind of inversion component, or rather, that makes some kind of reflective component. But there is some amount of randomness there, and that's what makes the inversion part. And so, right? You can kind of like, you could talk your way through it if you had to. Notice, Fong includes what they call an ambient illumination term. The idea of an ambient illumination term is if I turn off all the lights in a room, my ambient term will still give me a slightly lit surface. Right, so you can see that here, right? Like they've turned off all the lights and you still see this pigment dot. This is obviously a giant hack, but the idea here is that in the real world you would have global illumination, right? Like part of the light that I see on the people in front of me here is being bounced off the floor, right? But nothing about our rendering model can capture that. So instead, we just assume that global illumination is roughly just constant light coming in from all directions, and so that would be an ambient term. This is not physics, right? This is just some hack. But in practice, it works pretty well. And another way to think about it is that it kind of softens out your rendering model, right? Because there's just some base color that's there. Because otherwise, I mean, think about what would happen if I lit a Lambertian object with a spotlight, then literally underneath it would be black, right? And even if you're in like Kresge Hall down the way here, and you do that, and you know, they turn off, they dim the lights, they turn on the stage lights, and you have to do symphonies playing or whatever, you still like can see yourself a little bit, right? Like, so it's pretty realistic to have that. Yeah?
Why don't we do illumination before? I thought we would just ray trace somebody's face.
Good. And that's called global illumination. And what happens in global illumination if you retrace? What do you think?
Lots
of rays. It's really, really slow. Because there are a lot of different ways light can get to you, right? If I'm not just accounting for light to me, then I have to account to like light to tau, to projector, to screen, to me, right? But that's a lot of different passages. Yeah. Right. So here's this Fong illumination model in its full mathematical glory, and now you can kind of see what's going on. So here is this ambient term, you can see it's completely constant, it doesn't do anything. The second term is a cosine term. Right? Notice, by the way, partially thanks to this ambient term, this is not a BRDF. Okay? Because there's not even a cosine. Like I couldn't, which makes sense because our BRDF is like the fraction of light energy that gets reflected off. But somehow this ambient term ignores energy and just emanates color. So this is, but anyway, it's an easy formula to implement. Okay, so you have ambient plus dot product plus the specular term, which is very easy to know. That's what select is pretty good. Cool? All right. By the way, I would personally, I don't know, Tao, wouldn't you, I would probably put the ambient term outside of that 1 over r squared. Right, because it's literally, like, it has nothing to do with the light. Yeah. I think that depends on how you think about it, right? Whether you're thinking about it, you just reflect off a light in an ambient fashion in all directions, or whether you're thinking of just, like, their existing light in the room. Again, all of this doesn't matter. They're both just different shading levels. Will I quiz you on whether or not Falling has a 1 over r squared on the outside? Absolutely not. Yeah? And if there's ever a question on your homework, then ask. Yeah? It's a very easy way to fix that problem. Okay. So is this physically based? No. In fact, if you like work out all the spherical integrals, because like maybe you know you were in the 1980s and you were really excited that Fong somehow looks correct, you say, oh, well maybe there's a physical reason why Fong is right, so I'm going to integrate this out and see that it converted because there's energy, then you're wrong. It doesn't. It like can increase energy, it can decrease energy, all kinds of crazy stuff. Yeah. And in fact, it doesn't even really conform to how to do BRDF because you know, this ambient term, like, is just generating light from nowhere. Yeah? But it is sort of the standard and very basic computer games, and you can see that it really does make some pretty reasonable models. I don't know if you guys can see, thanks to the light in this room, these different spheres are shaded with different Q values here. So obviously, as I increase Q, the highlight from my light gets sharper. And that's function. Any questions about that? Pretty straightforward at the end of the day. It is constructed to have properties that we see in objects. Right? So it's not physical, it's just like somebody wrote down the three things they noticed about materials and that's what they tried to code. Cool. Alright, so if you want to be fancy, you're too cool for Fong, you can start to include other effects like this Fresnel effect. By the way, somebody rightly at the end of lecture a couple lectures ago pointed out that I said something really dumb. Which is that total internal reflection has nothing to do with why you see stuff reflected off of the ocean when it's far away. But rather, is effects like this, right? So, I think, you guys can correct me if I'm wrong. Again, not an optics guy. But roughly, Fresnel reflection, the idea is that when I'm like close at a grazing angle, suddenly things have more specularity, right? They're, like, they become more shiny. So for instance here, you see this is a picture of a really old computer graphics textbook. If I look at it, like if I look at this table kind of downward, it just looks like a diffuse table. And as I kind of get right up, you know, kind of parallel to it, all of a sudden it looks reflected. Yeah. In fact, a great example of that is the material right in front of me. Yeah. Right. And so this is called Fresnel reflection, and the nice thing is you can capture it in BRDF. It just becomes a little more complicated. Yeah. One version that tries to capture this is this Blinn-Torrance variation of the Fong shading model. What they do, and again, these are just constructed and totally like this function happens to have the properties that I like kind of white. They compute the halfway vector between the light and the viewer. Right? So remember the viewer, that's the vector that points to the camera. The light is the vector that points to the light. I literally take these two guys and divide them by two, the halfway vector. Because why not? And I compute this angle beta between that thing and the normal. And if I look at cosine of beta, this actually has this kind of funny property that as I begin to graze the surface, I get more reflectance again. And so that's this Blinn-Torrance version of Fong. By the way, I claim that this vector h is the halfway vector, which is weird because there's no 2 in this formula. You guys see why that's the case? Yeah, normalize it, right? So if I put a 1/2 here and a 1/2 there, they just cancel. Okay. Cool. Right. And so if you look at the lobes for the Blinn-Torrance thing, they're somehow when you have this grazing angle, they become a little bit more like it's a little more forgiving when you get to the grazing angle. So literally, when you're designing BRDFs, just the same when you're like designing your particle system, when you're designing your spotlight. Like, what do you do? Well, you literally plot this thing over a sphere and just design a function that you like for your material, right? It's really as simple as that. So these are kind of historically the models people care about. But it's not like any one of these comes from, you know, actually trying to understand the way that light interacts with some material. However, a paper in 2005, you'll notice that two of those authors are actually faculty in our department, really did verify that somehow this half-wave vector loop, if you do some experiments, aligns with physics. Right? So this is after the fact. It's not like they derived from physical first principles that this is the right formula, but rather just that they measured a bunch of material and showed that like, you can fit them pretty well into this form. You guys see the difference? Like, I keep kind of harping on this because I think it's important to remember that like, this is modeling, it's not physics. Okay, cool. Right, so this is the beginning of what people can call microfacet theory. This is the idea that really, when you have a surface, somehow it's really like composed of lots of tiny mirrors, right? And these mirrors are the things that are bouncing off of, right? So like a terracotta object would have lots of itty bitty mirrors that are all sort of randomly oriented, and that's what gives you this cosine fall, because that's kind of the probability that a random mirror is pointed toward you. Whereas, you know, in the delta function case, the mirror is super, super flat, yeah? Yet another thing that we haven't accounted for in the shading models we've talked about so far is that sometimes your mirrors might actually be occluded a little bit, right? So think about, you know, if I have a really rough surface, like this one at the bottom of the slide here, yeah? And I have, the light is coming in from the upper left, I have the viewer on the upper right. So far, we've accounted for things like variation in the normal. This would be the difference between like Berlin version and mirror shading. But something else to notice is that actually the bumps occlude each other. You guys see that? Like, so if I reflect off of this guy toward the viewer, then like this little bump is going to get in his way before it gets to my eye. And so even more complicated, BRDF models try to account for that in a statistical way. And so that's roughly what's going on with this half-wave vector is somehow, you know, the fraction of mirrors that are halfway between the viewer and the light. And so what you could do is try to take a BRDF, that tells you something about the ratio between the number of mirrors that are shadowed versus the ones that are masked. And that's what gives you this Fresnel coefficient, right? So if you go through this math very carefully, then you can get all kinds of crazy BRDFs. And rather than do that in this class, because we only have like 15 minutes left, I will point you toward all kinds of very famous papers over the last 50 years that derive this stuff. One of the nice things is if you're not a physicist, you can open any of these papers, type in the formula they have, and all of a sudden you have a really nice lighting model. Yeah? So you can choose the amount of wildly crazy physical light. But some of these really do the statistical physics that's required to figure out the amount of light that's bounced off when you have a surface where the normal is like randomly drawn from whatever Poisson distribution over the sphere, and you want to be very careful with it. And what comes out is very realistic stuff. Yeah? So a great example is this Cook-Torrance lobe, which is this totally wild and crazy function of just about every possible parameter you can think of for your surface, including the normal, the specular coefficient, this half-angle vector, the roughness of your surface, which is like the width of your lobe. Sometimes you add a diffuse term. There's this very complicated Fresnel function from statistical physics telling you how much stuff gets occluded when you look at different angles on a bumpy surface. And you put that all together and you get a really, really, really nice highlighting surface. Yeah. In fact, one kind of fun paper to look at is this designer BRDF function where they say, like, let's say I want to shine a light on a surface and have it reflect a star. Right? Well, you can actually design BRDFs that do that. If you took a pillow pad to a piece of metal and you like scrub it really, really carefully, you could probably pull this off. But it's very unpleasant, right? So anyway, they managed to solve this inverse problem that can create all kinds of crazy materials, like things that reflect stars, or even apparently they managed to reflect a teapot, which is like impressive. I think it would be very hard to 3D print this and actually, have it in the lab. If you can, that would be a great class. And I would gladly take an extra one from my office. So essentially, at the end of the day, what we do when we try to understand BRDFs is just look at it until we're happy, right? And so in this world, like you've already seen a lot of in this lecture, what we end up doing is rendering a bunch of spheres, typically with some environment map around it, right? So this is just some like kind of realistic lighting distribution of every sphere and just see what it looks like in that environment and whether it reflects what you like. Right? So for instance, here maybe you acquire the one on the left-hand side, and really when you acquire, it's like taking a photo of a sphere, you know, with a particular material like we talked about. And if you try to fit the Blin-Phong model, like do statistics, you know, least squares and fit, you get some shading like this thing on the right-hand side. Roughly, what is this telling you? This is telling you that Blin-Phong is not a great model for this material. And you can see why. Like, for instance, this surface seems to have highlights right at the grazing angles, which is not something that's captured. Whereas if you add Cook Torrance, right, remember that's this thing that accounts for grazing angles, suddenly you get that shape. Yeah. And so if you look at software for designing BRDFs, essentially what that software does is render this lope and then just lets you kind of tweak different parameters of your material model until you're happy. Yeah. Or another example, maybe some surfaces have more than one lobe of reflectance, like maybe there's a primary bounce and then some other secondary thing that's wider or a little bit angled because we brushed it a tiny bit. So that would be an example of what's acquired on the left-hand side. If I fit Cook Torrance, it ends up looking too sharp because I just can't capture that, right? But if I do the sum of two Cook Torrances, then I can get that. You guys see the difference here? I'll toggle back. So it looks very subtle, but really artists will spend quite some time designing this very carefully. So then one final thing that people do a lot of, and I encourage you to take the computer vision class if you'd like to learn more about techniques for doing this, is something that's called image-based acquisition. Notice, by the way, that there's this name in a lot of these slides, which is Wojtek. This is a faculty member in our department who was one of the early people that studied a lot of these problems. Right, the idea here would be literally like I take a photo of a scene and I start pointing at different objects in that scene and ask you for what their reflectance model is. Obviously, in numerical analysis, we would call this an ill-posed problem, right? What that means is that you do not expect to be able to recover like the full BRDF of Magnus by taking this photo, but you might be able to do a reasonable job, and the reason is that you see more than one point, right? And so actually you do see some amount of combinations between the normal vector and light and camera position, and maybe you can kind of extrapolate what's in between, or maybe you also can extrapolate a full kind of environment map from your scene by placing a metallic sphere there or something. And so there's a very famous data set of BRDFs that you can download and play with. Literally, they just added a bunch of BRDFs, and now they're there for your user. Yeah. So you can get some really crazy ones. So here, I think they even managed to actually kind of engineer microgeometry on the surface, like place facets in a particular pattern, so that you really do get an interesting thing. So I encourage you to look at this paper. It's impressive that they pulled it off. I'm not sure who uses it, but it's kind of cool. Yeah. Okay, one final note before we end today's lecture. All of these calculations depend on a few things, right? They depend on where the light is, they depend on where the viewer is, and they depend on a third thing, which is back in my wheelhouse, which is the normal vector to your surface. Yeah? And let's say that I have a surface that, for whatever reason, is composed of triangles. Well, a surface that is composed of triangles, but for whatever reason, I don't have it at very high resolution. Wow, it's like Gone with the Wind out there. Or not Gone with the Wind. What am I thinking? Tap Your Heels Together.
Wizard of Oz.
Kansas is what I'm looking for. So remember that a really critical piece of this calculation is the normal to your surface. Yeah? And what is the normal to a triangulated surface? What does it look like as a function? Well, it's not a great function, right? Like it's constant along a triangle, and then you go to another triangle and it flips. Yeah? And so if I render triangulated surfaces, even if there are thousands of triangles, well, you have thousands of triangles and typically billions of pixels in an image, right? You talk about megapixels a lot. What's gonna happen? Well, you're gonna see the edges of the triangles because somehow there's a discontinuity in your shading, right? And that's bad news. Yeah? And so typically you don't use the actual normals to your surface, like the honest-to-goodness triangle normals when you do shading calculations. And there's a long history of different hacks for how to get around this issue. It really makes sense that essentially if you use the normals to your surface, then necessarily you'll have discontinuity in your self-replicating, and that's bad news. Because your human eye, by the way, is like made to find things that are discontinuous. Right? Like, do you know all these perceptual studies where like you have two gray boxes next to each other and they vary by like one tiny, tiny value of RGB and you can see it? Because your eye is tuned not to see absolute values, but rather to see differences in things. Right? So in fact, your eye will actually accentuate differences in stuff just so you can see those lines. Because you're always looking for predators. So this is a long-winded way of saying that you really don't want to shade charges using your actual model. So in effect, typically what people do is store one normal vector, not per triangle, but actually per vertex of a triangle mesh. I think you actually did this in one of your assignments. Notice that is a weird thing to do, right? Like that somehow mathematically, that's a little strange. Again, ill-posed is the word we should use, because vertices don't have normals, right? If I have two planes that meet at a point, and I ask you what is the normal at that point, well, it's a whole set of things, yeah? And so in reality, you choose some random, well, not random at all, some reasonable choice of normal at the vertices, right? For instance, it's like the average of the triangle normals next to the vertex, yeah? And then when I ask for the normal at some point in the interior of the triangle, I like maybe interpolate the normal vectors from the vertices to that point. And that way at least you smooth your shading function very smooth. Yeah? And so this is sort of the very typical trick to do, right? So maybe I have a triangle, all three vertices have different normals. By the way, you might store the normals through your triangle mesh as just separate data on your mesh because you're like, let's compute it. And then you average them, and this is another example of barycentric interpolation, right? Three vectors. You have a barycentric coordinate, and you average the intercept. Is there any problem with that? Obviously, because I asked and I paused. What is the problem? If I have three unit normal vectors in the vertices of a triangle, and interpolate them, it might not be unit in this, right? In particular, think in the really extreme case where I have a triangle, and one normal is like that way, and the other is that way, and I add them together and divide by 2, I get 0. Yeah? And so your code really should be quite careful when you deal with that case. You're kind of clamping in a particular way. Or if you're really fancy, you compute geodesics on S2, right? So like the shortest pass on the unit sphere, and use that for your calculation. Yeah, these are all things people do. Another thing that we haven't talked about yet, but we're going to cover in the next couple lectures, is we've assumed that the BRDF is constant along your whole surface. Right? Like it's all kinds of boring teapots, like the one on the left-hand side. The reality is that most teapots, at least geometrically, not necessarily topologically, look like the teapot in the middle here. And this thing has different reflectance depending on where you are. Right? Like maybe the blue paint and the red paint. Well, the blue paint and the white paint reflect material light differently. Yeah. But thankfully, we're going to talk next about how to store textures for a surface. Right, so a texture, so it's like a JPEG that you can like read off a color for a triangle or whatever. But you can actually also store the coefficients of your BRDF as a texture as well. Right, that's perfectly fine. And then just when you carry out that shading calculation, not only do you figure out where you are in your texture coordinates, then you do all your BRDF stuff. Yeah. So anyway, that's all for today. In this low pixel image, because it was from a long time ago, you can see. One of these guys from the Matrix is real, and one of them is shaded on a computer. And I encourage you guys to stare at this at home, download the slides, and try to figure out which one is which. And in reality, this is just to show that shading models are really, really good now. And a lot of that really is engineering very careful BRDFs, as well as accounting for things like subsurface scattering, which we'll talk about later, right? Like a skin, light doesn't just bounce, right? It also bounces. Okay, so with that, I will see you Thursday, or I'll see you in my office hours tomorrow, when we'll talk about another.